toward the mark. The high calling of God in Jesus. Surely goodness, mercy shall follow me. Everybody, let's go higher.
Put your hands together.
Come on, Miranda.
If you're going.
My brothers and sisters, such a joy to be with you once again. Oh, what a glorious day, what a blessed day it is. It's just good to be with you in this time of study of God's Word together. As always, I want to encourage you to invite your fellow church members, your neighbors, your friends, your community members to join in with us and let's go higher together. For this is the day that the Lord has made, and we rejoice and be glad in it. We want to invite Ms. Tana Pope to come and lead us in another song, as she always does such a wonderful job with. Let us hear from her.
When I think about the Lord, how He saved me, how He raised me, how He filled me with the Holy Ghost, how He healed me to the uttermost. When I think about the Lord, how He picked me up and turned me around, how He placed my feet on solid ground. Oh,
when I think about the Lord,
yeah, how He saved me, and He raised me, He filled me with the Holy Ghost, He healed me to the uttermost. When I think about the Lord, turn me around, He laid my feet on solid ground. Hallelujah! Thank you, Jesus. Lord, You're worthy. And the honor and the praise.
Thank you.
You're so worthy. We thank You.
Thank you, Tana, for that wonderful song. Thank you for blessing our hearts once again. Well, as I told you on last week, we're going to start the Advent series on today. And we're going to look at those four themes of our Advent, where we're looking at hope, peace, joy, and love. And I should explain a little bit about the Advent season and the Advent wreath that you see up beside me here. The Advent wreath, it is a wreath that reminds us of the preparation that we need to do in anticipation and expectation of Christ's second coming. The concentric circle, it represents God's eternal love for us. The evergreen that you see on the wreath, it represents the everlasting life that he has for us. The three purple candles represents the penitence, the repentance that we need to do, straighten out some of the crooked places. Candles in general represent the light. Jesus is the light of the world. He comes to bring light in the midst of darkness. And we are the light of the world as his representatives here on this earth. And we should let our light so shine among men so that they may see our good works and find their way home. Of course, the pink candle represents joy. And we know that Jesus brings us joy. And the white candle in the center, it represents the Christ candle. And we typically light that on Christmas Day or the Sunday leading up to that Christmas morning. I know this is a little different. We normally do this during the Sunday morning worship service, but in as much as we are not having many people come together during this pandemic, I'm just going to share in this lighting of the Advent wreath during our time together here. So the first candle is the candle of hope, and I will be dealing with this Bible study on the theme of hope today. So this first candle of Advent, we're going to light it in recognition of the hope that Christ brings to us. Let us pray. Eternally most gracious God, we thank you right now for allowing us to know that we don't have to be in despair. We don't have to give up on this journey, but our hope truly rests in you. And our hope is sure and it's certain right now. We expect, oh God, that you're going to see us through this pandemic. You're going to see us through these difficult times, and you're going to see us through this life's journey. And as we focus on you, keep our minds stayed on you. We know, oh Master, that you're going to guard our hearts and you're going to guard our minds and you're going to give us that perfect peace. And you're going to keep us on that straight and narrow road, that road that leads to eternal life. And we won't be out on the Broadway where there are many off-ramps, but we want to stay on the straight and narrow way. So we pray for your Holy Spirit's strength, your Holy Spirit's power. We need you right now in such a time as this. We pray for all those who are sick among us, those who are recovering from illnesses. We just lift them up to you right now, and we just claim the victory for them. We know that you are the great healer, the great physician today. We pray for those who are going through some storms in their lives, and we know these storms come in many forms and shapes and fashions, and I just pray, oh God, that you'll just put your hands of grace and mercy on them right now and hold them right now and let them know, oh God, that everything is going to be all right. We give you praise right now in advance. We give you praise, oh God, because we know that trouble doesn't last always, and you're going to work it out on our behalf. In Jesus' name we pray. Bless our time today in this Bible study. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Well, I've read to you, well, I guess I haven't read the scripture for you. It's 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 13. 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 13. And the word reads, therefore, with minds that are alert and fully sober, set your hope on the grace to be brought to you when Jesus Christ is revealed at his coming. Therefore, with minds that are alert and fully sober, set your hope on the grace to be brought to you when Jesus Christ is revealed at his coming. I want to use for a theme for our study today, set your hope. Set your hope. What is hope? Hope is an expectation. We expect things to get better. We expect that trouble is not going to last always. We expect that a vaccine is going to come. We expect that our relationships will get better, won't always be rough and rocky. We expect that our finances will improve. We expect that the Lord is going to work some things out on our behalf. We expect the sun will shine again in our lives. Won't always be dark, won't always be gloomy. We won't always be stuck in the miry clay of life. But we're going to rise up to the buoyancy of hope. We expect these things. Now, J.I. Packett, an author, he wrote that people were born to hope. People were born to hope. Now, hope is a little different than faith. Faith is a belief. It is an absolute confidence that God will do what he said he's going to do, that God can and God is able and God will work it out for us. That's what faith is. And in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1, the Bible teaches us about faith. It says, now, faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. Faith is confidence in what we hope for. It's confidence in what we expect. And can you see the difference? Faith is confidence in what we hope for. Huh? You know that what you're expecting is going to come to pass. But hope is the expectation. You still trusting, you still expecting that things can change, that things can be turned around. Now, here's the tricky part. If you give up on hope, if you stop expecting that a change is going to come, if you stop expecting that God can use the doctors, if you stop expecting that God can get you out of trouble, that he's a bridge over trouble, well, you stop expecting that God can turn your situation around, then you will lose all your faith. Because faith is contingent upon your hope. Now, after you elect a few presidents, a few senators, and your circumstances and your situations, they don't change, then can't you see how easy it is for others to give up? We give up hoping on this journey because our hope is set in the wrong place. Did you hear what I said? We give up hoping on this journey because our hope is set in the wrong place. It's misplaced. Our minds are not alert and we are not fully sober. Peter submits to us today that our hope is misplaced. Our mindsets are drunk on dependence of worldly things, worldly ideas that we may never achieve. And those of us who by chance may achieve a few things, those things will not bring satisfaction, but they will be hollow and they will be empty. This text is so appropriate for this season that we're in. This season where we're doing a lot of buying. Cyber Monday, they expect billions and billions of dollars to be spent. This season of giving, getting, I want to get this, I want to get that. I want this, I want that. This text is apropos because it causes us to keep our hearts and minds focused on what is spiritually important. There are a lot of things that we are fixated on that do not feed our spirit, but they feed our flesh. Peter suggests that people are drunk with the world. Those who are seeking out the materialistic world are not prepared to live for Christ. If you're seeking out the materialistic world, you're not prepared to live for Christ. You're seeking out the materialistic world, you're not prepared to embrace the hope that Christ offers, because His way are not our ways. His thoughts are not our thoughts. Oh, no. And so Peter is trying to warn us, my brothers and sisters. Galatians chapter 6 and 8 tells us, whoever sows to please their flesh from the flesh will reap destruction. Whoever sows to please the Spirit from the Spirit will reap eternal life. Or yes, he's trying to warn us about the dangers and the perils of being disobedient. Disobedient to God, and then there are some advantages to obedience to God. Peter doesn't want us to sleepwalk on this. He wants us to be very aware of the dangers and the perils of feeding our flesh as opposed to feeding our spiritual side. How do you sow to your flesh? Is that your way of life? To live for self and pleasing your desires? Or as I reflect on life, I see that there are so many classes set up in this society. We have so many that are not satisfied with what they possess. We're never satisfied with what we have. We are drunk with wanting more of the world. We want notoriety. We want fame. We want more money. We want a better job. We want a nicer car. We want a fancier house. We want clothes. We want to travel. We want to post it on social media and let folks know that this is what we are doing. This is how we are living. This is what our priority is. But what are we advertising in terms of the spiritual side of us? What are we letting folks know about that? How much is too much, my brothers and sisters? When is enough enough? Can we be content on less? Is it better for us to focus on less? Does materialism draw us too far away from the Lord? Does it draw us too far away from the way He'd have us to walk? Does it draw us too far away from the throne of grace and mercy? Does it keep us from praying and seeking Him? Listen to what John says in Luke chapter 3. Because we got to set our hope, my brothers and sisters. And John tells us in Luke chapter 3, verses 11 through 14, he answered, anyone who has two shirts should share with the one who has none. And anyone who has food should do the same. Even tax collectors came to be baptized. Teacher, they asked, what should we do? Don't collect any more than you're required to, he told them. Then some soldiers asked him, and what should we do? He replied, don't extort money and don't accuse people falsely. Be content with your pay. John was preaching repentance. John was preaching changing your life, preaching preparation for the return of Christ. The people wanted to know how they should get prepared. And John tells them, he said, share with the poor. You got two coats, you got two tunics. Don't just keep both of them for yourself. You don't need all that. Share with somebody who is in need. There can be always be somebody in need. The poor you will always have among you. I think about that first Christian miracle in the book of Acts when the lame man was brought and laid outside the gate called Beautiful. And every day somebody had to bring this lame man and lay him outside the gate called Beautiful. Right behind the gate was the church, the temple. And all that praying, all that praising going on up in the temple. But yet every night the lame man went home, he was still lame. We've got to share what we have. That's what John was preaching. He said, told the tax collector, don't take more than you're supposed to take. As you know, tax collectors during those times, they were notorious for taking more than they were supposed to take. So they were getting paid and then they were taking more from the people. Then the soldiers tell them, to don't bear false witness against folks. Don't say that they are breaking the law or that they are worshiping other gods or so forth when they are not doing that. And then you need to be content with the money that you're making. That's what John tells them here in this text. And so George Cawood, he wrote a book, and in that book he asked this question. He said, do we want the Almighty God or do we want the Almighty dollar? Which one is it? Do we want the Almighty dollar or do we want the Almighty God? He said, we can't have both of them. You can't serve two masters because if you get one, it's going to draw you away from the other. And I don't know about you, but in this rat race of society that we're living in this materialistic world that we're in, if I get the Almighty God, he will pull me away from that almighty dollar. He'll pull me away from this materialistic and worldly society that we live in. And I don't know about you, but in times like these, oh, what a blessing that is. I don't have to pull my hair out if I had any. I don't have to be stressed out. I don't have to be worried about how little I have or how much I have to spend during this season because that's not my focus. That's not what I'm pushing. That's not what I'm preaching. That's not what we're teaching in our house. It's not about the almighty dollar, but it's about the almighty God. My. Jesus knew that. That's why he turned down all of Satan's offers of materialism. All of his offers of, you know, give you all of this fame, the kingdom of all this, of this world. Jesus didn't want to, he said, man cannot live by bread alone, but you need every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. You need the Lord. You need to feed your spirit. The Spirit will lead us to not take advantage of the poor. The Spirit will lead us to advocate for the poor. When we do things of the Spirit, they feed our spirit and we will reap the good things of the Spirit, which ultimately, I don't know about you, but at the end of the day, when all of this is said and done, when I've gone the last mile on this journey, when I've done all of my singing down here, I've done all of my praying, done all of my serving, done all of the preaching, done all of the teaching, done walked the last mile of this journey, ultimately, I want to hear him say, well done, thy good and faithful servant. I want to hear him say, come on home, my son, and take your rest. I want to know for sure today that over in my Father's house, there's a mansion waiting on me. He's got a place reserved and carved out with my name on it. I want to make sure my name is written in the Lamb's book of life. Ultimately, Ultimately, our reward for feeding our spirit is eternal life. It's eternal life. And we need to understand, my brothers and sisters, that Jesus did not come to take away from our life, from our lives. He did not come to harm us or to make us miserable, but he came to give us life and to give it to us more abundantly. The devil, Satan, comes to kill, steal, and destroy. And that's what a wrong focus, a misplaced hope will do for it. Will destroy us, destroy all of our joy, all of our peace, all of our hope. Peter tells us to have an alert mind. He says, be fully sober. Have mercy. Have an alert mind. Be fully sober. Be ready. Be prepared for action and be sober in spiritual things. In other words, let me see you walk the walk like Jesus wants you to walk. Let me see you be an advocate for the poor. Let me see you go visit the prisoners. Let me go see you. Let me see you visit those who are hospitalized. Feed the poor and the hungry. All of these things. Let your mind be prepared to act. I'm not talking about just going down to the Salvation Army on Christmas Day. That's fine. On some holiday or to the Faith Rescue Mission. But every day, your life ought to be a life that's prepared to act on behalf of the poor. Find ways you don't have to wait for the church to lead you in the service. Oh, no, 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 no. You don't have to do that. So many of the poor in our communities are also chasing after that almighty dollar. That's a sad thing. So many of the middle class is trying to make it into the upper class. So many of the rich are trying to get richer. Peter reminds us, because we have all been guilty of sin and we've been drunk on materialism, that we should set our hope not on the world, but set our hope on the grace that Christ will bring when he returns. Hope for grace. Hope for a savior. Hope for a redeemer. Hope for a mediator. Hope for mercy. Hope for the day when there won't be any haves and have-nots. There won't be any rich class or poor class, but we'll all be one class, all sinners, saved by the grace of God. What does it mean to set our hope? It's not enough just to say that one day Christ is going to do all these things for us. We must change our thinking. We must change our mindset. That means that we must guard our hearts and we must guard our minds this holiday season and not get caught up in the I want this and the I want that. We can't get caught up in the materialistic things. We can't get too disappointed or too distraught if things don't go the way we want them to go. Our focus must be on trying to know and understand the will of God. We must do our best and try to work and live like Jesus wants us to. We got to live like he wants us to every day of our lives. Advent means that we are preparing for Christ's second coming. We know that he came that Christmas morning. We celebrate that on Christmas Day. But he's coming back again, and that's going to be the most important thing. Important day that we need to make sure that we're ready. We don't want to be asleep. We want to keep our lamps trimmed and burn. We want to be alert. We want to be sober. Keep our minds clear and focused on his second coming. Straighten out all the crooked places. Our actions have to demonstrate where our hope rests. If you're tired of being last, if you're tired of being the tail, then set your hope on the grace that comes from Jesus Christ. Set your hope on that. If you're tired of being at the bottom, if you're tired of being looked down upon, set your hope on Jesus. If you're tired of coming up lacking and short, set your hope on Jesus. You can change your whole situation right now. You can change your whole status. You can change your whole perspective on things. All you got to do is come out from amongst them. All you have to do is just make up your mind that the world and its materialistic things will not be your focus anymore. You can have joy right now. Your hope can go up to a new level if you just set your hope on Christ, on the grace. Well, I'm certain that many of us, we have really more than we need to survive in this world. We really do. But our hope is just focused on the wrong thing. And again, this Advent season, it gives us an opportunity to straighten out some of that, to prepare for the Lord's return. We have an opportunity to focus on higher and more nobler things. Oh, yes, sir. Oh, it's nice to have things. Huh? But can you be content if those things are stripped away from you? You know, I remember when I was just a kid in Sunday school, and we read this parable in the Bible about the wise and foolish builders. It says that the foolish man built his house upon the sand, and the rain came, and the wind blew, and knocked his house down. But the wise man, he built his house upon the rock, and that rock was Jesus, and the rain came, and the wind blew, and it beat upon that house, but that house stood. On Christ, the solid rock, I stand today. All other ground is sinking sand. I don't know about you, but my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and his righteousness. I don't want to trust. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but I'm wholly leaning on Jesus' name. On Christ. That's what the hymnologist says. On Christ, the solid rock, I stand. For all other ground is sinking sand. I don't know about you, but I'm like the Apostle Paul in Philippians, where he says that I have learned how to be content. No matter what situation I find myself in, whether I have a lot or whether I have a little, I feel okay. I'm going to be okay. I'm going to be able to pray. I'll be able to, even if you put me in prison like Paul and Silas was in. One sing a song and the other pray the prayer and have a worship service there. And if you want to get the attention of God, you just keep hoping, keep believing, keep expecting for God to rescue you. Keep expecting for God to change some things. Keep your mind alert. Keep your mind on spiritual things. And as always, my brothers and sisters, let's go higher. Let's go higher. We'll see you next time. And we'll look at the theme of peace as our second week of this Advent season progresses. God bless you, and may God keep you. That's my prayer.
The high calling of God in Jesus. Sure, goodness, mercy shall follow me. Everybody.
Let's go higher. Put your hands together.
Come on, Miranda.
If you don't.